Thank you so much, Lisa. And good evening to all of our attendees. Thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Tatiana. As Yolanda already introduced me, I am a PhD student in economics at Columbia University. I am also the project manager for the Undergraduate Women in Economics Challenge and one of the conference organizers. I am, for this evening, delighted to be your moderator for the recent graduates, Where Are They Now? Panel. And just to go over a few logistics, we will start with some moderated questions for our panelists, whom I will introduce shortly. And after that, we will go into a Q&A session, and I encourage you to raise your hand and ask the questions directly, and I will be moderating this. But if for some reason you are unable to, please also feel free to drop your questions into the chat, and I will keep an eye on that and can ask your question to the panelists. And so without further ado, let me introduce our panelists. So joining us today, we have Ali Jakubek, who is a supervisory compliance analyst at the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City. She was also an intern in economic education at the Richmond Fed. Also joining us today is Rob Sharp, who is a senior applied scientist at Uber and who has been there for 8 years. And he has also worked as a research associate at the Federal Reserve Bank of Richmond. And our last panelist in the evening is Arushi Saksena, who is a senior analyst at Compass Lexecon. So welcome. So with that, let me jump into the first question of the evening. So let's go around, and if you could please introduce yourself, give us your name, undergraduate degree and institution, and tell us one way that you use economics or economic tools in your current work. And let's start. I'm just gonna go in order that you folks appear on my screen. Let's start with Allie.
All right, we're gonna play a game called Does My Microphone Work?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. I play it every time I enter one of these meetings, so I'm glad that it went well. My name's Allie Jakubek. I graduated with an economics degree from the University of Mary Washington in Fredericksburg, Virginia. Currently working as a supervisory and compliance analyst in the statistics department of the Supervision Risk Management Division at the Federal Reserve Bank of Kansas City. And one way that I use economics in my job, I'm a part of a survey called the Small Business Lending Survey, which tracks the demand for loans to small businesses and how banks around the country are able to supply those to small businesses. We compile and analyze the results and publish it in a quarterly release every quarter. So reminds me a lot of my like econ analysis classes that I took in undergrad. So that's a cool, I guess, piece of my past that I'm happy to have with me in my career.
Great. So next, let's go to Rob.
Cool. Hey, everyone. I'm Rob. Also, does my microphone work? Can you hear me okay? Okay, great. I'm Rob. I have a math and econ degree from University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia, and I now work as an applied scientist at Uber in the marketplace org. Econ is really pervasive in this job. So I work on pricing optimization right now. And I think one area where we use economics tools heavily is in trying to understand the externalities when someone takes a trip. So obviously externality is a very like econ concept. But for example, if you're a rider and you want to take a trip into downtown, like right before PM rush, that's really good because we're going to be undersupplied downtown. And so it's really valuable for other people if you get one more driver into that location. And so trying to estimate the magnitude of this impact and then incorporate that into the price. So we actually want to somewhat subsidize your trip to make it more likely to go downtown. It's like a very, very econ heavy problem. We're using a lot of economics tools, structural modeling. So I'm using it in my work every day still.
Great. Yeah, that sounds like I'm sure there's at least a few people who've taken an Uber or Lyft or used ride sharing. So very, very topical, definitely. And Arushi.
Hi, everyone. My name is Arushi Saksena, and I did my undergraduate degree at the University of Chicago. I studied economics there. And I'm currently a senior analyst at Compass Lexecon, which is an economic consulting firm. And so as the name of the industry suggests, I use economics in my work pretty much all the time. And clients generally approach us with some economic problem that they're trying to solve. And this might include things like evaluating the potential value of a merger and acquisition, or finding out how much a company's share price should have actually been valued at a given point in time. So everything that we do kind of involves economic thinking in some way or the other on a day-to-day.
Great, thank you for sharing those insights about your work. So for the next question, can you please tell us a little bit about how you became interested in economics? What or who got you into this field? And when you decided to study economics, what was the path, the career path that you envisioned for yourself? And did you actually end up following with that path? And for this, let's start with Rob first.
Yeah, sure. So when I went to college, I didn't know anything about economics, and I kind of took it on a whim. It's a pretty common course for undergrads to take, Econ 101. And I just kind of fell in love with the subject when I took that course. Like, I like to think about the world quantitatively. I like to try to model things mathematically in my head, and it just like scratched that itch for me. So I got really interested, kept taking more classes, eventually decided to major in it. So that's kind of how I stumbled my way into the field. I think when I decided to major in econ, I didn't have a clear, like, concrete vision for what I wanted my career to look like. I thought maybe I might want to go into academia, but overall, I was just kind of interested in learning any set of useful skills and seeing where that took me. And that's kind of the way I've approached my career, is just like at every step, like just figuring out what next step makes sense without necessarily having a concrete vision where I want to be in 5 or 10 years. So yeah, that's the best answer I think I can give.
If I can ask a follow-up question, and this would apply to the rest of the panelists as well. How did you end up finding your current position? Was it, did you just find it kind of by chance? Did somebody recommend it to you, or in some other way?
Yeah. Great question. So I think I found my way into the field of, I guess, like data science by talking to people who had more work experience than I did. So I worked at the Fed, and I was trying to figure out what to do next. And through those conversations, I kind of learned about this field, and it seemed really interesting to me. So I got a job at a different company first. And then once I had worked in the field for a year or two, I kind of had a better sense of what kinds of problems I was interested in. I've always been interested in cities and transportation. So I applied to companies like Uber and Lyft and was able to get this job. So yeah, that's kind of how I ended up here.
Great, thank you. Arushi, what about you? What got you interested in economics, and how did you end up in economic consulting?
So I took my first economics class in high school, and I immediately fell in love with it. And I think that was specifically because economics kind of ties to everything. I'm particularly interested in cinema. I did my minor in college in that as well. And then I realized that there's so much economics in even the film industry, for example. So that kind of fascinated me and reeled me in. And then as I started exploring options in college, I knew I wanted to do something economic research related. And I took a lot of part-time jobs with professors and kind of started doing econ research. And someone in my research job kind of recommended the economic consulting industry. I initially didn't even know what that was, but I did some research, I learned more about it, and I realized that it might be the perfect fit for me. And kind of in response to your follow-up question for Rob, in my college, the econ consulting recruiting cycle started in the fall. And then I went into it knowing that that's exactly what I wanted. And then I just recruited, I spoke to a lot of people at different firms, and then I ended up in this industry.
Yeah, and I think that's a really helpful point as well for students to keep in mind, that the economic consulting recruiting does happen very early. So it's important to kind of stay on top of that at the beginning of senior year. Ali, what about you? Tell us about your journey in economics.
So similarly, I got really interested in economics when I was in high school. It was in my government class when we had to read the book Freakonomics. I became obsessed with the book, with all of the things that econ could be, and like weirdly obsessed with the Federal Reserve System. So I remember I was at a Super Bowl party, and one of my brother's friend's moms worked for the Board of Governors. I cornered her, talked to her for the entire night about her job at the Fed. And I was just like, one day you'll help me get a job, or like one day I'll work with you. I don't work with her, but I do work for the Fed. So I'd say that was a a success for me, but definitely every 16-year-old was not like dying to work for the Federal Reserve. So that was my goal. Because of my obsession with the Fed, I also had a passion for education. I wanted to be a teacher, but I was like, maybe I could be a PhD economist at the Fed and I could be a professor on the side, because like I had a professor that was like that in college. Quickly realized that I would never get my PhD because I'm terrible at calculus and math. So kind of put that to the wayside. And though I'm not, you know, necessarily an economist at this point, and I'm not, you know, a college professor, I'm still at the Fed. So kind of ended up where I thought I was going to be. And being in something that's mission critical to the Federal Reserve System is really special for my job. And this is kind of tied into my challenges section, but since I knew I wanted to work in the Federal Reserve System, I just like applied for literally every job that was open from fall of 2017 to spring of 2018, got denied from all of them but one, and kind of just kept pushing. That's how I ended up where I am today.
Well, I think that's a perfect segue into our next topic of discussion. So, I mean, it certainly sounds like, you know, there's a lot of twists and turns that can happen. And even if you're, you know from the outset what your dream is, it's to work at the Federal Reserve, there can still be a lot of challenges that come up. So if you can talk a little bit about the challenges that you faced and how you've worked to overcome that and what's helped you in that process. And Alice, since you've already started us in this discussion, if you could elaborate a little bit more about maybe some other challenges also, and you know, what has helped you to kind of overcome them?
Sorry, I'm like playing with my unmute button. So I mentioned it previously, kind of my aversion to calculus and math kind of hindered my career at first. Robert talked about how he really likes the quantitative side of econ. I liked the theory side. I liked the history. I liked all the touchy-feely economic stuff, which I think did hinder me when I look at some of the jobs that I applied for, which was over 70 throughout the board and the Federal Reserve System. A lot of them were maybe kind of not necessarily where my passions were in the field. And I was just kind of I got really discouraged. I had experience at the Federal Reserve System, and I thought that, you know, I was hot stuff, honestly, in my economics department. I had jobs in the department. I knew all my professors really well. But the only job that I got was the one that I have right now. And I think the thing that got me through that and how I overcome that big challenge, which was my biggest challenge in my career thus far, was the relationships that I made when I did get the opportunity to work. So the relationships that I made in my internship the first time around, the relationships that I made with my professors, those were super important to overcoming the challenge of just getting rejected from jobs that I probably was not qualified for at all. Having people to serve as a mentor and kind of lead you in the right direction, and also tell other people that they should care about you too. That's super important and has helped me overcome a lot so far.
Yeah, as someone who's also currently in the job market and applying to a lot of jobs, I can definitely relate to the fact that kind of the connections you make along the way is what helps you get through it, definitely. Arushi, what about some challenges that you may have encountered and how you've dealt with them?
So when I was searching for a job, definitely being an international student was one of my biggest challenges. Fortunately, a lot of economic consulting firms do sponsor, but you have to work extra hard and you really have to nail the interviews. So it was a long process, but ultimately it worked out for me and a lot of other people I know. After that, it's pretty much smooth in terms of getting your paperwork done because all of these firms have such big legal teams that are so experienced. And then, you know, another challenge going into the actual work, I would start on a project or task and there was so much going on and there's such big teams that sometimes you kind of forget to step back and look at the big picture of the case that you're working on and you focus so much on your one task that you're doing. And that was something that made it a little harder for me to kind of tie in what I'm doing to the economic theory of the case we're working on. And so what I started intentionally doing to overcome this is every time I would work on something and would have to send work product to my manager, I would write a short paragraph in the email kind of detailing what my results mean in the context of the case and what some next steps I think we should be taking are. And this forced me to reflect on what I'm really doing and kind of what direction my findings can take. And that has helped me overcome that challenge for sure.
Yeah, I really love that. I think it's really important to remember that economics, you know, it's not just the number that we get on the page, you know, from solving the equation or analyzing the data. It's also, you know, there's meaning behind it, and it can, you know, it has a lot of weight. So thank you. Rob, what about you?
Yeah, I think when I moved into, I'll just say like quote unquote industry. So after working at the Fed, when I got my first job in data science, the process of finding a job the process of finding a job, like figuring out what types of jobs to apply for, and then having the confidence to apply and interview, that was difficult for me. Like I had a lot of self-doubt. I wasn't sure like how I could apply all these skills I had learned in some sort of like, quote unquote, like real world problem space. It was very silly because in the end, I had all this self-doubt. I ended up talking to like Arancha and Pierre, who are kind of like mentors at the Fed. I talked to my older brother. And once I started talking to people, they pointed me in directions like you should look into this field, this field, this field. And I think that just grounded me and just helped me understand that like, you know, I had a very useful set of skills, and as long as I stuck with it and kept applying for jobs and kept looking around, I would eventually find something. And then I think once I found a job and started working there, like quickly learn the skills that you need on the job. So yeah, I don't know. I guess a lot of self-doubt at first, and then it totally got better with help from mentors, like I think other people mentioned.
Yeah, that was a kind of a theme that came up yesterday as well in the Diverse Careers panel. And to folks watching who were not able to attend, I encourage you to watch that recording because there was also a lot of great advice shared there. But one of the things that came up was sort of this idea of reaching out and kind of opening up yourself and you know, talking to other people about your struggles and how that, you know, that creates the opportunity for other people to help you as well. So great. So with that, we'll now open it to Q&A. So if you have a question, please feel free to use the raise your hand feature to ask a question, and I will call on you. And so please take a moment. We'll give you a moment to figure out kind of what your question is to formulate that. And also, you know, don't be shy. Everybody here wants to give advice, wants to offer, you know, wants to help you out on your economics journey. So I encourage you to raise your hand. All right, I see Jason Rourke as a stand-up, so please go ahead.
Yeah, can you guys hear me well?
Yes.
Okay, this question is for Ali. Can you just talk about what it was like to be an intern at the Fed? I'm going to be going through a similar experience soon, so it'd just be nice to hear maybe some feedback on what that was like. Thank you.
Yeah, for sure. One of my intern mentors, Sarah Gunn and Yolanda, they're both right here. So I had the pleasure of working in the economic education department, which was probably the most fun area that you could possibly work in. Experience as an intern, this was back in 2017, so I don't really know how different things are now, but it was incredible. We had a big group of us, some of which I still stay in contact with today, who still work for the Federal Reserve System, so I get to chat them on a regular basis in Teams. They made it a point to get us together as a group and have us network within our intern class. Mine was like an everyday, you know, 8 to 5 kind of gig. I got a lot of exposure across the bank and got to experience a lot of things that I don't think, I mean, obviously I wouldn't have gotten to go work at the Fed if I didn't have an internship at the Fed, but just getting to learn the ins and outs, the acronyms, the Fed-isms, and even just, you know, being familiar with the Fed systems, that was super great. But overall, the experience is excellent. I'm really excited for you. If you have an internship, you're going to love it.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you for your question, Jason. So we have, I'll moderate the questions in the chat as well. So we have one from Jessica Lee. So the question is, how has the job market changed over the past year? And this can either be from your own experience or from observing kind of the experience of people around you in the hiring process and what you might have seen. And I'll open this question up to anyone who wants to answer that.
Yeah, I could jump in really quick. I think at the beginning of the pandemic, there was a lot of uncertainty. And I know that we had layoffs and a lot of other companies in our industry did and kind of froze hiring. But I'd say over the last 12 months, hiring has picked up a lot. And right now, we're hiring at a higher rate than we have at any other time since I've been here. And I know friends and colleagues who have had like many more offers than I think they would have had in a typical time before COVID. So I think like there's a lot of hiring going on right now, which is kind of nice, but it could vary, I guess, field to field.
And are there a lot of opportunities for like remote work? Because I know that's a very like hot topic right now.
Yeah, definitely. So in our industry, like all the different companies are competing with each other to try to be more remote friendly because that's how they attract employees. So the remote policies have gotten way, way better. Like our permanent policy now is only 50% of time in the office. Like you can work from home 50% of the year. So, and I think that's not atypical. So yeah, that's changed a lot.
Arushi, what about in economic consulting? How have things changed from what you've seen? And there are a lot of opportunities remote work.
So very similar to what Robert said, in the beginning it had slowed down a little bit, but right now I think there's actually a higher demand for people in the industry, especially at the analyst level. And I think almost everyone I know in other economic consulting firms as well, they're all actively looking for more people to join. So that's definitely a positive. And then in terms of remote work as well, right now we're fully remote, but from January onwards, we're going to start a bit of a hybrid schedule where you can go in once or twice a week if you want to. And I think that it's pretty seamless working with people who are in the office and people who are working remotely. So they don't have a problem with you working remote.
Great. So now let's jump to the next question. So I see Kai Amato.
Yeah, thank you. I think Ali kind of answered this, but maybe the other panelists did, but I was just curious if you guys like considered getting like a master's or a PhD, or you kind of knew like that you wanted to just jump into the workforce and start getting experience that way.
So I waited to get any sort of like further education until I actually started in my job so I could get something that was like directly related. And I'm currently pursuing a master's degree in data science, which I would say is like a huge, whether you're in the economics field or anywhere else, I think that there's a huge push towards data science right now. So even though, you know, an econ PhD was not in the cards for me, once I got into my job, I realized that a data science degree was really, really useful.
Yeah, I actually agonized over this question for a long time, whether to try to pursue a PhD or not, and ultimately decided against it. It wasn't the most well thought out decision, but I think for me, I'd always been someone who, like, I had been in school my whole life, and I just wanted to try working for a couple of years and see how that went. So that was ultimately why I made that decision. But now I work alongside a bunch of PhDs, so I think no matter which way it had gone, I probably would have ended up in a similar position. Just kind of reassuring.
Great. Let me jump to.
Thank you.
Arushi,
just said thank you. Sorry.
no problem. thank you for your question, Kaya. Arushi, did you want to also chime in on that question?
Sure. I just wanted to say that I also considered getting a master's degree, but I do plan on getting one soon, but I wanted a few years of work experience as well before I started thinking about that.
Great. I'm going to jump to a question in the chat. And then Cora, you'll be on deck with your question. So this question is from Javeria Piracha, who's a freshman at Hollins University, intending to major in applied economics and mathematics with a data science concentration. And they are an international student from Pakistan. And this Arushi, this question is for you specifically. Javeria is wondering, do you think you faced any discrimination based on the fact that you were an international student? And if you did, how were you able to overcome it?
Sure. So I didn't face discrimination, but there are some firms that don't hire international students, but you, for the most part, you know that upfront. So you decide not to apply to those firms in the first place. And then for the firms that do hire international students, it's pretty much a level playing field when they're doing resume reviews. And then once you're actually selected for an interview as well, it's more about how you do in the interview, not so much about any other background details. So I wouldn't say that there's discrimination as long as you know where to look and as long as you work really hard to show that you are worth hiring over maybe someone who's not international.
Great. So now let's jump to Cora. Cora Haskett.
Hi. I was wondering if you guys could talk about, some of you talked about the more like theoretical aspects of economics. I think Ali, you mentioned that. And then also like the more like Arushi, I think you mentioned remembering like the bigger picture. So how do you feel like you guys balance kind of like the smaller specific problems of economics and like the overarching themes as you're doing your work?
Sure, I can start. So in addition to, you know, making sure that I think about what my numbers mean, I also keep remembering and keep, I also keep up with whatever I had learned in terms of theory. I still read books in economics here and there, and I'll keep up with news related to that. And I think when my mind is constantly thinking of that stuff outside of work, then it automatically applies to my work life as well. And so on a pretty regular basis, I am always thinking about these things. Additionally, at Compass, they do have a lot of seminars, especially during lunchtime, where someone who's an expert in some specific field of economics will come and speak to you and kind of talk about what's new in that line of work and how that's tying to our industry. And so the, on a firm level as well, there's a lot of opportunities to keep thinking about these things.
Great, thank you. I see Michael Lee also has his hand up.
Yeah, hi. My question is sort of about the transition from undergraduate to into like industry or into working. So I was wondering what kind of or how well you feel that the skills you learned from an undergraduate degree translated into working, and if there were any like gaps, what skills did you find filled those gaps?
I would say something that I guess I wish I had when I entered into the workforce, I had to learn more so on the job when I started. The applications that I used for my degree, we used a lot of Stata and we used like nothing else. When I got into my career, I was using SQL, I was in Excel, I was in Tableau, I was using all these different applications that I had literally never heard of before, that I'm sure would have gotten me, you know, maybe further ahead in my job when I first started. So I would encourage you, I mean, the theory and the critical thinking skills that you get from an econ degree, those are priceless. You know, you can apply that to any aspect of your life and you're going to be set. But the tangible programming skills and application skills, those are things that I didn't really get. And I would highly recommend kind of take those free online courses for SQL and Python and R and stuff like that and get your feet wet there.
Yeah, I would echo that 100%. And I think the other skill that you don't naturally learn in college is, or like soft skill, a few soft skills like time management, prioritization. I think it's hard to learn those things without practice. And it's expected that you'll come into a job being a little bit maybe fresh and just learn them on the job. But yeah, that's another set of skills that I think are extremely useful. Maybe sometimes overlooked. Like Ali said, the skills you're learning in undergrad are priceless. Like they will set you up for success.
And I will maybe piggyback on that because as an undergraduate, I definitely took advantage of a lot of different workshops that the university, not the department, but the university organized that kind of help you to learn time management skills and sort of these soft skills that maybe your professors don't have time to teach and maybe you didn't learn in high school, but you realize actually come in handy. So I encourage you to, you know, maybe like career offices or other departments on like university offices, you know, if they offer these opportunities to definitely take advantage of them.
Even so like the external groups that you're involved in outside of your major, like those will help you more than you know. If you're involved in anything other than just your econ major, use those for your job and interviews and stuff.
Great, thank you.
So we have a couple of questions in the chat. So Hong Nguyen, so the first question was about internships. So are there opportunities for people who currently are not labeled as economics majors, but are interested in working in economics or Fed international area? Is that area kind of exclusive for econ majors or are other majors able to get in? And is there a field associated major that is that needs more growth? And I guess since it's a Fed related question, I don't know if Allie, maybe you could take this.
We have a whole wealth of people who work, even in my area, which is very like financial statistics related. We've got finance majors, business majors, econ majors. I think we have a communications major. It all depends on how willing you are to apply yourself to the job and honestly how passionate you are about the work that we do. So if a field is something that interests you or if a job is something that interests you, don't let your major hold you back just because you don't think it's directly related. Find something that really fires you up about the job and really sink into that.
And I'll jump, I'll take the last question from Hong Nguyen as well. And that'll be our last question in the Q&A just to make sure we stay on time. If you could list the programs and workshops that you would recommend for job training. And Arushi, actually, if you could start us off on that, you know, what were maybe some programs and workshops that help you to get prepared for the interview process for consulting? Because I've never gone through it, but I know from friends' experiences that it can be very, very stressful and very time consuming.
So definitely Stata and R are some of the big ones that we use in econ consulting, as well as Excel and the more complicated features in Excel. But I will say that at least for economic consulting, they don't require you to know all of this beforehand. And there are a lot of specific training modules that you have once you start that kind of equip you with it. Of course, it's definitely an added skill if you do know it beforehand. And if it's on your resume, it might bump you up to the top. But it's definitely not a requirement or a necessity. And then in terms of the right places and workshops to learn these skills, for me, because I did a lot of research with professors at University of Chicago, I kind of was learning it on the go and developing my skills and that trained me. But then there are a lot of online courses that also teach you how to work with these.
And what, just as a follow-up, what were some of the ways that you prepared for the interview process for economic consulting?
Sure. So, you know, the first few rounds that I had for economic consulting were largely behavioral, but you should have a good idea of what your resume includes and then expect any follow-ups on that. So if I'm talking about my senior thesis, then I had to be prepared and make sure that I can answer any follow-up question about my thesis, for example. And then there are some case interviews as well, but they're not as stressful as a management consulting case interviews. They're more about just understanding what your thought process is and how you approach problems and kind of just knowing what you would do if you were presented with a specific economic problem and what kind of data you would want to use and how you would approach that data.
Perfect, thank you. So let's wrap up the session with maybe with one final question to leave the students with some advice. So if you had to give one piece of advice to students who were interested in your field and were starting out, what would that piece of advice be? So let's, we'll give everybody a chance to answer this one. Let's start with Rob. What piece of advice would you give?
Yeah, I hope it's not too cliche, but I would just say, like, stay focused on learning. So in multiple ways, like, find people who you think are doing good work, try to copy them, ask them questions if you can, seek feedback, try to find learning resources online. I just try to keep learning. And I think, you know, slowly over time, you will just build such a wealth of skills if you do that. And you'll look back 5 years later and maybe be happily surprised with where you've gotten to. So yeah, that's what I would say.
Allie, what about your piece of advice?
I would say get passionate about things and get loud about it. Find the things that you love and just really go for it and make it known to everybody that you talk to that, hey, I'm that girl who loves education. I'm the girl who loves community development. I love, you know, reading Adam Smith. I don't know, whether it be your obsession with a certain thing about economics or, you know, just something that you're really passionate and interested about, let people know so that when they see an opportunity that comes along, they immediately think of you. It'll make your job a lot easier too. If you find things that you're passionate about, find mentors that will open doors for you and present you with opportunities that align with your interests. You're going to be a lot happier in your career. And yeah, you'll just have, I think it'll just be better for you. So that's my advice.
Great. I love that. And Arushi, what about you?
So I was going to say something very similar to what Ali and Robert have said, but I'll take it one step forward then. As you're learning about what you want to do and as you kind of explore those options, start reaching out to people in the industry that you want to work in, especially the ones who have the same role as you or the same role as the one that you'll be applying for, and absorb as much information as you can, because not only do you want to know that this is the industry for you, but you also want to get some sense of which firm's culture aligns best with what you want to do and what you're looking for. And I know from personal experience, everyone I contacted when I was exploring my options in college, they were all super helpful and incredibly honest with me about what to expect and what not to expect. And that really helped me make a lot of decisions as I was going into the recruiting process.
Great, thank you so much. Well, thank you all, Ali, Rob, and Arushi. Thank you so much for joining us for the session today. There was some amazing advice and experiences that you shared with us. And I'm sure the students, you know, are also very thankful for hearing these insights from you. So our panelists are going to, I think, stick around just for a few more minutes. So if you have any follow-up questions that, you know, you kind of came up with in the last few minutes, please feel free to send them a message in chat, and you know, they can respond as we're transitioning to the next session. I will also drop my email into the chat. So if you have any follow-up questions, please feel free to email me. Any of the panelists who you know can share their emails as well. I'm sure they would be happy to follow up too. And so with that, I will now hand it over to Arantxa Yarke for the next session.